Hello everyone, welcome to the session on data structures. In this session, we'll be discussing about introduction to the data structure. In this session, we will see what we mean by data structure, what are the different types of data structures, and what are the operations that can be performed on data structures. Friends, as you know, that you are viewing this session on my YouTube channel, Learn with Prakash Khanare. And do not forget to subscribe to the channel to see many videos in the subjects of electronics and computer science. So let us start the session with the question, what we mean by data structure. Now, all of us, when we live in India, we know that the government of India has been issued us an Aadhaar card. In the Aadhaar card, you can easily observe there is a lot of data. The data such as the name, the date of the birth, the gender, and every Aadhaar card has a unique number. So in real life, we always want to deal with a different sets of values. The sets of values such as the name of a student or the name of a person. It is also possible that we can deal with other data items such as the cost of the item. Every student is being assigned with some roll number. Every person living in India has an Aadhaar number. Every city in India has a PIN code, and also every student will score some kind of marks in the examination. So whenever we are dealing with different situations, then actually what we are doing is that we are dealing with the different sets of values. These sets of values will represent the facts, and these facts are called as the data. The data item refer to the single set of value, and such single set of value is being called as an Aadhaar number. So this is the primitive data element or the elementary data element. Sometimes the data item can be further divided into different subatoms, and such data item can be called as a group item. Say for example, when we have a name of a student, then the name can be further divided into first name, middle name and last name. So you can call such data item as a group item. Collection of the data need to be organized, and it need to be organized in such a way that we can make an efficient access for the data. So whenever we are dealing with the data, we need to store the data in computers, in digital machines. And this data must be stored in such a fashion that we can make an easy access to the different data elements. So you can say that the data structure is a way to organize the data in computers so that whenever we want to make an access to the different elements of the data, then this access can be made in an efficient manner. Now we know that as far as the storing of the data or organizing of the data in computer is concerned, there are different ways by which we can organize the data. And therefore, we can say that there are different data structures. So what is the data structure? Data structure, you can say that is a way of organizing the data in computers. So let us first of all understand some basic terminology that is being involved in the data structure. As we know that there are certain data elements or data items that cannot be further divided. And such elements or such atoms can be called as the primitive data elements or elementary data elements. Say, for example, the roll number is a unique number and it cannot be further divided into different atoms. So it can be an elementary data element or primitive data element. Some data elements can be further divided, and such data elements are being called as the group atoms. Say, for example, the name of the student can be further divided into three categories, such as the first name, middle name, and last name. And therefore, such data item can be called as a group item. Data item may have certain property. And whenever the data item has the property, then that is being called as an entity. And this property can be assigned with some value. And this value can be either a numeric value or non-numeric value. Say, for example, when we consider the property or attribute such as an age, then we can assign a value such as 23 to the age. Entities with similar attributes is being called as an entity set. For example, when we consider employees of the organization, then that will form an entity set. Or when we consider the students of a college, then that forms an entity set. Every attribute of the entity set has a range of value. The range of value will refer to the set of all possible values. Say, for example, when we consider the attribute such an age, then the age can have a value in the range of 0 to 100. The data with the given attributes is being called as an information. That is, whenever we process the data, and when we process the data, then it is being called as an information. Say, for example, when you have the data of marks of the students, then you can process the data and you can obtain the information such as who are pass and who are fail. So whenever we want to obtain the information of pass or fail students, then this is an information which can be obtained from the data such as marks of the student. Now let us go for some elementary data organization. The data can be organized into the hierarchy of fields, records, and files. Field, you can say, will represent an attribute of the entity. For example, a roll number can be one field. Name of the student can be another field. Or the mark score by the student in different subjects can be another field. So the field can be any number of time. We can have any number of fields. Say, for example, we can have 3 fields as shown in this example. Roll number is one field, name of the student is another field, and the marks obtained by the student is the third field. Record, you can say, it is a collection of the field values. So when we enter the roll number as 1211, name of the student as Prashant, and the mark score by the student as 55, then that will form one record. And when we have such collection of all the records, then you can call it as a file. So file is just nothing but the collection of the record. As shown in this diagram, we have a file where in the file we can have 3 records, where the record 1 will consist of 3 fields, the record 2 will consist of 3 fields, and the record 3 will also consist of 3 fields. And every field will have a certain data or value associated. So whenever we have the data of all students in a class or in a college, then that can be called as a file. A record may contain many fields, but you will find that one of them can have a unique value and it is not same to the other record. Then that unique value can be called as a primary key. Say, for example, when we consider the data of students, then the roll number of each student is different from the other, and therefore the roll number of the student can be a primary key in such data. A file can have a fixed length of records. Many times the length of the records is fixed, but it is also possible that you can have a variable length record. So if you are having a change in the length of the records, then it is necessary to mention what is the minimum length and what is the maximum length for the record. Say, for example, whenever we are fixing the length for the field such as roll number, we can fix it up to 4 digits. We can have 20 characters for the name, and we can make the use of 2-digit or 3-digit for storing of marks. Fields, records, files, these are the elementary data organization techniques. But these techniques are not sufficient in order to process all the types of data. And therefore, many times while writing the programs for real life applications, it is necessary that we can have many more complex data structures. Say, for example, we will need the other data structures such as arrays, linked lists, stacks, trees, queues, and graphs. So let us see what are these data structures. Data structure you can say that is a way of organizing the data. But in order to organize the data, what you need is the logical and mathematical model. And therefore, we can say that the logical and mathematical model that is being used for organizing the data is being called as a data structure. Data structure can be classified basically into two categories. The first category is being called as a primitive data structure, and the another category is being called as the non-primitive data structure. So as shown in this diagram, we can have the primitive data structure such as integer, real, character, and Boolean. And we can have non-primitive data structures such as linear data structures and non-linear data structures. In the linear data structures, again, we can have the different types of data structures such as arrays, linked lists, stacks, and queues. In the non-linear data structures, we are again having the different types such as trees and graph. So let us understand what we mean by these different data structures. Primitive data structures are those data structures that cannot be further divided into other sub-items. So such data structure are being called as the primitive data structures, or many times they are called as the simple data structures or data types. Say, for example, integer number, real number, a character, or a Boolean number can be called as a primitive data structure or data type. You will find that it is not possible to further subdivide the integer number, or the division of real number is not possible, and therefore these are being treated as the primitive data types. Data structure is being called as a linear data structure if its elements can be arranged in a sequence. So if the elements of the data structure forms a kind of linear sequence, then that is being called as a linear. For example, the data structures such as arrays, linked lists, stacks, and queues are the linear data structures. And if it is not possible to arrange the elements of the data structure sequentially, then in such a case, those data structures are being called as the nonlinear. Say, for example, trees and graph are the nonlinear data structures. Now, array is a linear list of elements. So whenever we prepare some list of elements, suppose you are going to a shop to purchase certain items, and it is possible that you may forget these items. So in order not to forget them, what we do is that we prepare a list of the items that are to be purchased from a shop. So such a list is being called as an array. Array can have either one dimension or it can have more than one dimension. And always we can make the use of a subscript variable, or we can make the use of the index variable in order to refer to the elements of the array. So as shown in this diagram, these are the elements of the array, where the elements are the integer numbers. The first element is 25, of which the index can be 0. So the index value can start from 0, or it may start with 1. The second element is 40, the third one is 65, the fourth one is 98, and the fifth one is 100. Of which the index value is 4. So this will refer to the lower bound of the index variable, and this will refer to the upper bound of the index variable. The another data structure that is being very commonly used is the linked list. A linked list, you can say that it is a list in which the elements has a link, or it can has a pointer to the next element. So linked list, you can say, are more efficient than that of the arrays or list. So list data structure is not efficient, but if you want to improve its efficiency as far as the insertion and deletion of the elements is concerned, then always we can go for the linked list. So as shown in this diagram, the linked list will consist of the nodes where each node will have a value and a pointer. A pointer will point to the next element. The next element will also have a value and a pointer to the next element. And the last element will have a value and it will not have a pointer, or the pointer value for the last element will be nil. So this can be the first element, and the first element in the linked list can be called as a head, and the last element in the linked list can be called as a tail. Tree is the another data structure that is very commonly used in computer programming. Tree is a data structure that has a root and leaves. And we can say that whenever we have a hierarchical relation between the different data elements, then such hierarchical relations can be easily implemented by using the tree data structure. So as shown in this diagram, the tree will have a root and then it will have the leaves, or you can have its siblings, and that can be called as the nodes of the trees. Every node can have the further nodes. So it can be called as a parent node. This can be called as a child node. And you will find that in a tree, we can have a subtree. And these, when there are no further nodes, then that can be called as a leaves of the tree. Stack is another data structure that is being used in order to implement many complex algorithms in computer programming. Stack, you can say, is a linear list in which the insertion and deletion will take place only at one end. So the list is closed at the other end, and whatever we want to insert or whatever we want to remove or delete, then that has to be done from one end only. This can be called as a last in, first out system. So as shown in this diagram, this is an empty stack where one can easily observe that this is an open end, this is the closed end. So whenever we want to insert one, the first element, then we need to perform the push operation. Whenever we want to insert another one, then again, we need to perform the push operation. And whenever we want to remove or delete anything from the stack, then we need to perform the pop operation on the stack. Queue is another data structure. You can say that it is a linear list in which the insertion will take place at the rear end and the deletion will take place at the front end. So insertion and deletion will not take place at the same end, but they will take place at the different end. And this data structure can be called as a first in, first out, or FIFO system. As shown in this diagram, this is the front of the queue where we can perform the deletion. And this is the rear end of the queue where we can perform the insertion or addition. You must have been observed that whenever we want to purchase a train ticket or a bus ticket, then we need to form a queue, isn't it, in order to perform such operation. Another data structure that is being very commonly used, and this data structure is being called as a graph. Graph, you can say, is a pictorial representation of the elements, and all such elements can be linked with each other. But remember that in graph, it is not necessary that the elements will have the hierarchical relationship. So it is possible that we can have the connection between the different elements, such as 0, 1, 2, 3. And these elements can be connected with each other. One can be connected to the 4, as well as it can be connected to the 2, and it can be connected to the 3. So these are being called as the vertices, and their links are being called as the edges. Now we will go for what are the different operations that can be performed on the data structure. You will find that there are different operations that can be performed. One such operation is being called as an insertion. So whenever we want to add a new element into the data structure, then that is being called as an insertion. Whenever we want to remove an element from the data structure, then that is being called as a deletion. If you want to visit or make an access to each element of the data structure, then that is being called as a traversing operation. If you want to find an element, whether it is present in the data structure or not, then that is being called as a searching operation. If you want to arrange all the elements in the data structure, either in ascending order or in descending order, say for example, if you want to arrange the marks from highest marks to the lowest marks, or if you want to arrange the names alphabetically, then this operation is being called as a sorting operation. Many times we need to combine two or more elements of the data structure together. And whenever we perform such operation, then that is being called as a merging operation. You will find that the insertion, deletion, traversing, searching are the most common operations that can be performed on any data structure. Sorting and merging is also required many times whenever you write computer programs. Now, whenever you want to perform any operation on the data structure, then you need to write an algorithm. Algorithm, you can say it is a set of steps that can be written to perform the operation. And every algorithm will be associated with complexity. So complexity of algorithm will refer to the time and space requirement in order to execute that algorithm. So it is always in terms of the input size. So attempt should be made that the time requirement and the space requirement will be minimum, and only those algorithms should be selected in order to have a less complexity. So thank you, friends, for viewing the session. Hopefully you have understood what we mean by data structures and what are the different operations that can be performed on data structures. Thank you all for viewing the session.